Hi everybody, and welcome to the absolute last episode of HammerFall TV that deals with the albums that we've done. Because now we've gone through albums one by one. This is week 11, so we've been doing this for almost 3 months, which is pretty incredible. But this is, we're up to the very final album of this series, and that's going to be a classic one, the one that I think most of you, many of you, or many people discovered Hammerfall with this album. At least that's what we hear. And so we're going to go back to 1998 and go through Legacy of Kings, which was a pretty interesting album for us in many ways, as you will soon hear. Because today we have a special guest, and it's only fitting that this album gets the rundown that it deserves, with not just myself, but with also with Joachim, of course. So I'm gonna bring him in here into the thing here. Let's see. And here we are. Hello. There we go, Joachim.
Hello. How's it going?
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you. How are you? Your dinner party, awesome. I heard.
I'm awesome. Yeah, that's why the red color. I mean, everything is red around here, isn't it? Yeah. It looks like you're in a strip club or something. I can't hear you now.
What?
I can't hear you.
There we go. Better?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you very much.
My microphone is, there's a glup.
Okay, something. It's a glup.
Yeah, it's a
glup.
I mean,
my superpower is that I can read lips, but I don't have my reading glasses on. So.
All right. Can you actually read lips, though?
Well, yeah, of course.
funny, I've known you for 24 years and I never knew that you were good at it, actually.
I know me for 50 years and I had no clue either, so. No, I'm just kidding.
All right.
I'm just
kidding. All right, so should we get down to it? Because I know that you are busy and
sure.
You have your dinner party going. So we're going to talk about Legacy of Kings today. Ah, I see. Champagne, I'm guessing.
Champagne.
Yes. Cheers. I have my own champagne. The champagne of Oscar.
What vintage are you drinking?
I think it's this year's, actually. I hope it's this year's. Anyway, so yeah, Legacy of Kings. This was back in 1998, our second album. We had come off a tour, or two tours, actually, with Tank and Raven, and then with Gamma Ray and Jack Panzer. And then we
also did our first headline tour during this period. We went to, to Belgium and Holland.
That's right.
And headlined a full tour on Glory to the Brave. And we had to explain to the promoter, hey guys, the first album is 45 minutes long. It's really hard to headline with the material, you know, for only 45 minutes. I mean, that's why we opened and closed with the same song.
Which song was that? I don't remember.
Child of the Damned.
We ended the show with Child of the Damned?
I mean, we needed to play more songs.
Yeah, yeah.
People want to hear more. We play all the cover songs that we knew.
Yeah,
and we played, let's do the opener once more.
That's fucking. I mean, that wouldn't really fly today. You know, it would be.
I think it would, because it was so crazy. People were. I mean, we didn't really have 10,000 people, as you might remember, but people loved it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That they did. They didn't want us to stop. I guess that's why we continued.
No. And they also, you see, the background looks a little bit like the backdrop on the previous tour.
Yeah, it does, actually. Like the video for Dominion. Where are the demons?
Upstairs. I'm in the basement.
Okay. Usually it's the other way around. The demons are in the basement.
No, the dragon is upstairs with the demons. Yes.
Okay.
If you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, let's hope she's not watching. But anyway, you said, you're right, we did this tour, this was in January, I think, right, of 1998, what was it?
Let's see here, yeah, I think so,
yeah.
I think so.
And we ended by recording a show in Gothenburg on January 30th, some songs ended up on the Heeding the Cold single as bonus tracks on that one, for example.
Yeah, that was at the Musique en Suisse.
Yep.
The show we did, I think Haunted played with us there, didn't they? Or was that the release party?
Yeah, that was at the release party, I'm pretty sure. Kings?
Okay, that's later. But I mean, that was a crazy show. I mean, yeah. Musique en Sus was 500 capacity, sold out. It was just crazy.
Yeah, it was insane.
Everything happened. Yeah.
I think at that point, when we played that show, that's when we realized, again, that, wow, this is something that's really, this is powerful, this force of Hammerfall right now. I mean, Wacken was one part, of course, the first show ever outside of Sweden and all that. But when we played this show in our hometown, and people were so frantic, it was just a really, really energized show. I think we felt the energy as well.
And we had a guitar tech, same guy who did the video for Renegade, and he couldn't really tune the guitars. So all the guitars were kind of a little slightly off during the whole show.
Oh man, I don't even remember. Was it Roger, right?
Yeah. No, don't mention his name, but...
Okay, yeah. So it was not Roger then.
It's really hard to sing when something is slightly... Yeah. Out of tune.
I can imagine, especially if all the guitars or instruments were out of tune in the same frequency, it would be okay, I guess. But now that must suck.
Then we're in tune. Yeah. Of course. But if I mean the bass, maybe Magnus tuned his own bass. He usually did that back then.
Yeah, he probably did actually. Now that you mention it. Yeah. So anyway, that's how it started. Like, now we're in songwriting mode. I know we had written some songs at the end of 97, but most of the songs, I guess, were completed at least in the first couple of months of 98. Do you remember anything specific about the songwriting? I don't really have much to say about that, but do you have any, like...
I mean, this was the second album. And like everyone says, well, this is the most important album. And I can really agree to a certain extent because, I mean, the first album, well, for us, we wrote the first album anyways in like 6 months. But for many bands, they spend years writing the first album.
Yeah.
Then they go on tour and they get like a certain success. And all of a sudden, they need to do follow-up. And like, oh, shit, we need to write songs now. And that was kind of the feeling we had. I mean, Glory to the Brave came out in June 97, and we had to come up with the second album already the next year, and we toured frequently on Glory to the Brave.
Yeah,
well, I never felt that pressure that people say, you know, it's going to be so hard to, you know, do a follow-up to follow up Glory to the Brave. I never felt that pressure.
Oh, no, I mean, I don't think I did either. I mean, like now that you mentioned, the Glory to came out in June of 97, and in May already we were in the studio recording Legacy of Kings. So, and then we did also, like you said, a lot of touring in between that. So I mean,
exactly.
we had a momentum going, I guess, you know, we were on the up, on the rise, so to speak.
Exactly.
And then I guess it's easier to.
I remember one of the songs, I was walking home from. I was still working. Was I still working? Like my regular day job? I'm not sure. But I got this idea. No, I was actually standing in the shower.
Yeah.
And I got the... it started like this. I went to Denmark with my sister and her family. And on the ferry, I read a sign that said, remember yesterday, think about tomorrow, live today.
Yeah.
And that kind of somehow... got stuck in my brain, so to speak. And when I was in the shower once, I started to sing a melody and use this phrase.
Yeah.
And I came up with something I thought was really cool. So I had to run out of the shower naked. You know, I was warding down the whole, apartment. And I was living on the bottom floor. So people, you know, if they were outside, they could see me standing naked in my living room. Singing the became the chorus for Remember Yesterday.
That's a fantastic story. So, but that's a really good ballad.
Could hear me when I did my absolutely. I think the whole neighborhood could hear me do my like the demo vocals because it was really lyhört, as we say in Sweden. Yeah.
Well, I'm
once
sure
when
they
you
didn't.
And Jesper came over. You were standing outside. Outside my door listening because it was so loud.
Oh, really?
When I was doing demos in my kitchen, yeah.
Yeah, I remember that when we moved your apartment from bottom floor, a one room apartment, to the third floor, three rooms apartment or something like that.
Exactly. I wanted to move, but I told them I don't want to change the address. It's too much problems. So I just want to move, to a bigger apartment in the same, to have the same number. Because all the companies with, both with HammerFall and my company was registered to this address, and I was too lazy to change that. So,
That's
yeah.
insane that you actually got it. How many apartments were in that actual on that address, like 27B or whatever it was? Was it C or B?
I think it was C, and I think for the C section was the C section, maybe four, five with the small ones
I mean, what
downstairs.
are the odds that you find that one of those apartments will will be free for you in the next couple of months
I
after
think
you?
my luck ended right there. That was kind of
That's
the
the
lucky strike.
last lucky thing that ever
Yeah.
happened to you.
Exactly. That was my trisslott, as we say in Sweden.
Well, it worked out anyway. All
Yeah, it did.
right, because I was watching the Legacy of Kings DVD. The bonus DVD that we did for the anniversary edition today, and I hadn't actually watched it before, the interview parts of it. And then you said that you quit your day job, and that must have been in 97, right? At the end of 97.
Yeah, we were supposed to go on a, oh sorry, on tour, a Christmas tour. I think was it with Venom back then? It was kind
Yeah.
of a Christmas thing,
Yeah, it's called, yeah, it was
and
called something, Christmas Metal Meeting or something like that, right?
yeah, but it got canceled somehow, and
Yes.
they didn't want to give me like a leave of absence from my day job. So I just said, you know what? Let's give this a try. It might work, it might not work, but I can always, go back to something else if it. If it won't, if it can't work. So Christmas 97, that's the last time I did something decent.
Yeah. Yes, like last time you had a real job, right?
A real job, yeah. Exactly.
But so anyway, so let's move forward a couple of months. Now we were in songwriting mode. We had completed most of the songs, I guess, when we did because we recorded a demo with Anders Fredén, of all people.
Exactly.
Was it? Did we share a rehearsal room with In Flames back then? Was that the time
Yeah,
when
we
we?
did. Yeah, just like at Fryshuset under Studio Fredman.
Yeah, exactly. So
And I think
how?
Anders just started his producing career.
Exactly. He wanted to try something out, I think. But did we record it in the rehearsal room, or did we do it in the Studio Fredman? I don't remember, actually. I think we
We
were in the.
played. Did we play live or did I add the vocals afterwards? I'm not sure, but we played in the rehearsal room.
Yeah. That's
And
what I
maybe
remember as well.
he was sitting upstairs, or he had some sort of a setup in the rehearsal room. I think so. I think
Yeah,
so.
that sounds. I mean, he was also rehearsing there, plus Studio Fredman, where he was. I think he was an apprentice or something at that time in Studio Fredman. So he was working one or two floors up. He brought just some
Yeah.
microphones and recording equipment down and recorded
Exactly.
probably wasn't a four track, but it was just like you said, we played live, and I think we may have added solos and vocals afterwards.
I
If
think
I'm
so.
yeah, I think that sounds right.
But that recording, to my recognition, my knowledge was fantastic. I remember
Yeah.
I really loved the energy, the drive on that actual recording. I
Yeah.
think it turned out being like a mono thing or something was wrong.
Yes, that one. The thing is, it was recorded on a DAT tape, or a DAT rather. And
Nice.
I have it somewhere here. No, sorry, I had it somewhere here. Gave it to Stefan for, and this was when he worked at GM Studios, which was a million years ago. But I never got it back from him, as far as I know. And the recording that he was supposed to transfer it to CD or to digital, this was like 2002 or something.
Yeah.
And the copy I have is only the transferred version. I don't have the original tape anymore. But the version I got from Stefan was unfortunately not. It was in mono, like you said.
Yeah,
So
something happened.
yeah,
Something
something
happened
happened
there.
there, which sucks because I mean. I'm gonna look for it again, but I don't remember getting it back, unfortunately. And I think that probably was just lost in you know, how yeah. however what happened with the studio, I don't know, but that sucks.
One of the highlights on the Glory, the tour of the Brave that we did together with Gummery, was that in was it in Cologne at the Bangerhead Festival? No, that wasn't.
Cologne was the metal meeting.
Festival was in.
Yep.
In the metal meeting.
Yeah.
But the first, was it the first Bangerhead we played in Balingen?
Nummer zwei, glaube ich.
Nummer zwei. Okay. Yep. Yeah. We met Andy Mück for the first
yes.
time.
Right.
The singer of Stormage, and this actually turned out to
wait a
collaboration.
Minute. Wait a second. Didn't we meet? This is how I remember, because Andy sang with us on stage at the Bangerhead show, so we met him before on the Tank and Raven tour.
Tank and Raven.
Yeah,
exactly. Or no, we met him the first time. Let me see here. In Merkers Dorndorf. That was the show that was moved because it was like a wedding. In the place we were supposed to play, so okay. they moved us outside. No, that was on Legacy of Kings.
Okay. Yeah. No. I'm pretty sure this is how it worked because we recorded that show or that song ended up with. We played at the end of the Rainbow Ravenlord with Andy Mick on that tour, and that ended up on the video. So we must have met him before. I think Markus Woskin was the fan club president or something like that for that. So okay. he introduced us to Andy at, I know it was outdoors. We have a couple of pictures from that, like we're doing this whatever bullshit, funny, drunken
yeah, just
shit.
In front of the tour bus.
Yeah, exactly. And this was on the Tank and Raven tour. I'm almost positive of that.
Was that the same time we went with him and his wife and I drank hot chocolate with whiskey?
possibly. this I can't.
Yeah, because I had a sore throat, so I thought like hot chocolate and some whiskey would help.
Well, I guess it couldn't hurt to try it.
No, I think it did. But somehow, this turned up. This kind of friendship with this meeting kind of became very, very important because together with Annie, we did the song at the end of the Rainbow.
Exactly.
That ended up on Legacy of Kings.
Yeah. And so, and Andy, for us, he was kind of like a hero for us. I mean, we've been listening to Stormwitch for many years, since we were teenagers, basically. So it was a huge deal to both meet him, sing with him, or have him on stage playing a Stormwitch song, but also, like you said, co-write a song with Andy Mick. That was insane. It was huge for us. But it turned out it had a backstory, apparently, this little thing.
We're going to tell that story?
Well, why not?
Yeah, well, it turned out that we had some extra songwriters on that song that we didn't know. And that was really a really bad story because just before the album was supposed to be released, a lawyer contacted the Nuclear Blast and said, you know what, I have my client claims that he wrote parts of the song. And if you don't pay him this much money, we're going to sue you, and we're going to stop the release of the full album.
Yeah, that was so terrible.
This was back in the Deutschmark days, and I think we paid them like 60,000 Deutschmarks.
That was a lot of money back then for this stuff.
That's a lot of money now.
Even still today, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that's a bit of a sad story, but... if you want to put a sunshine on the end of it, we had another hero of ours play the guitar solo on that song.
Exactly. Because on Glory to the Brave, we recorded a cover version of Warlord's Child of the Dam. And I got in contact with Bill Sommies, Thunder Child, that's the mark of the drummer. What's it? Destroyer.
Yeah, was it? I don't even remember.
Yeah, Destroyer.
Okay.
So I got in contact with him, and he loved our version, of course. Of course. And we asked him to play the guitar solo on the song that we co-wrote with Andy Mick.
Yeah.
For this album. So that kind of was cool, because the first cover song we recorded was Child of the Damned, and the second one, as far as I remember, was Ravenlord
by
Stormage.
So we sort of tied everything together there, really nice. And I remember when he's, because this was again in the age of DAT, digital audio tape, DAT tape, or DAT, DAT, whatever, DA tapes, I guess you call them. I don't know. That's how we say it in Swedish. Dats. Anyway, he sent two, I think, back that were not in sync with the music that we sent him.
No. I think he used ADATs.
Oh, was that what it was?
The DATs.
Okay. That yeah, okay. ADATS. Right. And it was... my friend Fredrik Nordström can probably talk about this if he remembers, but he spent a lot of time trying to sync them because somehow he had, because it's a digital audio tape, you have to synchronize the clock so that when you put it into the production, it's just there. But it wasn't synced. I don't know what the problem was, but something was wrong. So he spent a lot of time trying to fit the solo in because it was a different tempo because of the audio clock. And because of the digital clock. That took a couple of days, I remember, of him doing that.
I mean, a funny thing with the Studio Fredman back at that time, that was that he just got his first computer.
Right.
And he got a 2 gigabyte drive for the computer. And that was like a gigawatt. We never heard about, that size. We came from the 386 era. Yeah. And all of a sudden he had 2 gigabytes. So we could, use the computer for some small stuff.
It was unthinkable.
I think maybe that helped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, of course he did it in the computer. I'm sure that helped.
In the computer, yeah. And we also recorded the vocals in the computer.
Yeah, in Logic, I believe, right?
Everything. I think it was Pro Tools.
Really?
Wasn't it?
I don't know.
No,
I don't
remember. Actually, I'm just guessing here. I think, yeah. But well, all the vocals were done on the computer, but you were still on the U-matic tapes.
Yeah, we had these big, thick 2-inch tapes for everything else. So that's we spent about 2 months in Studio Fredman, including the mix, I think, to finish all of this. But we went on an excursion in the sometime, I don't know, after a couple of weeks, I don't know, remember exactly when it was, but we had the festival booked in the middle of the album recording. Do you remember this?
Was that in Holland or?
Yeah, the Dynamo Open Air.
The Dynamo Open Air, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I believe that's
when we first discovered a text message on the phone.
Really?
You can actually send text messages, yeah, on the ferry back home.
Okay, how the hell can you remember this?
Important stuff, you know.
Yeah, but Sweden were pretty early with the text messages. We did that a lot in the early days. I remember my brother lives in the U.S. and he, for them, it cost money for a long time just to send. And it was not only to receive SMSs or text messages also, and they didn't use it because of that. So they were years behind us back then.
Yeah, but back then it was cost a fortune for us too.
Yeah, I mean we spent some money on it, but it was much more expensive for them apparently, and that's why it didn't catch on over there. But anyway, text messages. Yeah, who knew that? That's what we're gonna talk about.
Well, you never know. What's going to happen?
No.
I'm just going to send a text message now. If you talk, you still see me, right?
Not when you do that.
Oh. Okay.
We can hear you, but not see you.
I was going to order some refill on drink.
Some refill? Oh, okay. You want another.
I need it, yeah.
We already spent almost a half hour on this, so if you want to go back to your dinner, it's fine.
No, it's okay. We can round this off. Another cool thing, we had a fan club in Gothenburg. It was run from Gothenburg, and I got in contact with the actor Bruce Campbell of the Evil Dead movies and Bruce McCann Jr. He was in Cena, Warrior Princess, Burn Notice.
Yeah, I mean that was after this, but of course,
that's one of his the big thing. But for me, he will forever be Ash in the Evil Dead movies. And I contacted him on like an official email address, and he got back to me and said, "Hey, nice, talking to you." And he gave me his private email address. So I sent him a question that, I love your work, maybe. Maybe you could appreciate what I'm doing. So is it okay if I send you a CD and you maybe can make a review for it? So I sent him the full Legacy Kings album and the single for At the End of the Rainbow / I Want Out.
Right.
because we did that also.
That was for the fan club magazine, was it?
Yeah, so I sent it to him, and he made a really cool review for the fan club magazine. That's one of the most memorable things, you know, to me around that time.
Yeah, of course, that's a big thing. That's really nice.
Yeah.
I mean, I was never a fan of him in the same way you were, but of course, I appreciate his work a lot. And I Burn Notice.
He is the man.
Yeah. I mean, I follow him on Twitter, actually. He's pretty funny. He does some funny stuff on there.
I mean, he is still such a sense of humor. He's kind of a slapstick master.
Yep. Exactly.
So upstairs now. They kicked me up.
Oh, but now we see you better even. But anyway.
Do I look better? Yeah.
Well, this, the red kind of distorted things a little bit, but it looks like you're in a place with a lot of gold albums behind you.
No, it's just paintings. Oh, paintings.
Okay.
Yes. So.
Somebody says Bruce Campbell likes Hammerfall. That is so cool. I don't think he actually liked it. Didn't he say that in the review? That this was not his cup of tea?
Well, definitely. But he loved the energy. And I sent him like a goodie bag on that album, and also for when the Renegade album came out. So the he was filming a lot in New Zealand back then.
All right.
I think that was for Cena and for Hercules.
Yep.
So I'll send him T-shirts, you know, CDs, everything, you know. So maybe he used the Hammerfall shirt once. I don't know. But
we can only hope.
It was worth a try.
Yeah, exactly.
Worth a try.
Yeah.
So, guys, I think I had to leave you.
Yep, no worries. Thank you so much for joining us. I think everybody appreciated it a lot today. So have a great dinner party. Say hi to your girlfriend and
the dragon.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if she was listening or not.
but
it was nice talking to you. Fitting end to this album series, I think. So I'm gonna get to some playing now, awesome. And eventually in a little while. But have a nice evening, continued, and take care of yourself. Talk to you soon.
Cheers.
All right. Bye. All right, there we go. That's as far as we got today with that. And so I don't have much else to say about this. I mean, we did discuss a lot of things. We didn't talk so much in depth on some things I had planned to, but that's fine. We're absolutely happy with this. So now I'm gonna go get to the playing a little bit about the album. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about the amps and stuff that we used, in case you're interested. The amp that I bought because of this album, I bought it for this album, but it didn't come until afterwards. So what happened was I've been looking for an amp that gave me the sound I wanted, like the heavy metal sound I wanted, and I couldn't find anything. I played, I recorded Glory to the Brave with a Marshall something, I don't remember. It was a modification thing anyway, and it sounded good, but that was not exactly what I was after anyway. So when we recorded Legacy of Kings, Fredrik Nordström, the producer of Studio Fredman, he knew that I was really into what kind of things I liked. And he borrowed a Engel Savage 120 from, I believe it's a band called Dark Ain, or Dark Arne, as Fredrik kept calling them. He has that thing of making fun of everything. And when I heard the sound that came out of their Savage 120, I was blown away. I mean, I really, really was blown away. It was just the perfect amp, I thought, at that point. It could not get any better because it had everything that I wanted out of an amp. So I don't know if I actually bought that before, or I think we recorded on their amp. And then I bought one during the recordings. Maybe it came during the recordings. I don't know. I don't remember. So this is the same one that I bought there. I had it since for 22 years. It's been through a lot, been on tour with us a lot of times, but even traveled on airplanes a couple of times which I don't recommend for a head like that, at least not if you check it in the regular luggage, which we did. Yeah, so that's the same one that I use. I still have. I love it. I mean, this is my favorite angle lamp. Fredrik just sent me a mail or a text message. Oh, text message, okay. Anyway, dismiss. apparently, he's not watching here right now. But anyway, so that's that one. I believe Stefan also used that. I don't remember, actually. He was into Marshall a lot back then. After the Gamma Ray tour, he wanted to have the kind of rig that that Kai Hansen had. It was a JMP1, I think it was called JMP1, like a rack version. He may actually have used this on the recording. I don't know anymore. It's such a long time ago, but I'm pretty sure he probably did, actually, now that I think of it. But anyway, as far as guitars go, so like I've told you many times before, I have kept all of my guitars I've ever owned in my whole life, except for the very, very first one that I bought. That was when I was 14 years old, just to try it out to see if I wanted to play guitar. So I wanted to, kept going, but when I sold that one and got rid of it and bought it, the one I wanted instead, which was the guitar I recorded Glory to the Brave with back in 97. So, but that's not the one now. So I bought another one for the Gamma Ray tour that followed after the Glory to the Brave album, but that was not a great guitar. It was a Jackson Randy Rhoads model, but it was a pretty cheap one. It didn't hold up well. I think it might have even have broken during the tour. Somebody fixed it, but it was not a great guitar. When we were recording, but I still want, I don't know. I don't know what I decided to record the album on. Probably that one or the first one that I recorded Glory with. But when we were in the recording, we were going to Moog, which is a very, very famous music store here in Gothenburg. It's a legendary music store. They've been around for, I don't know, 50 years maybe. No, maybe, probably not 50, but 40 years, I think. They started in the 60s. So yeah, 50 years for sure. I think so. However long they've been around, for decades, very, very many decades. It's a great, great store. Fun. We spent a lot of time in there. And this time we went to buy some drum heads, I remember. This was only Frederick and I during the... I think this was like when we were setting up the drums. We're just going to get some stuff that we could record with. All of a sudden, I walked in because they had a guitar section. The drums were upstairs. Frederick went up and dealt with that bullshit. And I went to the guitar section, like... All of a sudden, it was like in these movies, when you see something and then everything, the time around you stops, everything just freezes and light is just shining on that very moment. And you hear these things, you know, that's how it was for me, because that it was hanging there, like the guitar that I wanted. Like, if you know me by now, you know that I favored the Randy Rhoads model of Jackson guitars. Because of Vinnie Vincent mainly, also Randy, but mainly Vinnie actually, because that's how I got into that guitar, and it was just hanging there at Moog, you know, waiting for somebody to buy it. It cost about 500 euros, 5,000 Swedish, but for me that was an insane. Well, it wasn't an insane amount of money, but it was a lot of money just to buy something like that and spur of the moment buy like that. Because up until this point, I spent a lot of time. Working, you know, half time, getting welfare to cover up for the rest, you know, and studying and you know stuff. So I was living, used to living spares, you know, you could say. So 5,000 Swedish crowns was a lot of money for me back then, just to splurge on something. On the other hand, we were recording our second album following the very successful debut. And this is what Fredrik pointed out to me, because I told him, he said, "Oh, buy it," you know. And I was like, no, I can't buy it. There's no way, I can't buy it. Well, I can't buy it. And he just asked me, why not? Why can't you buy it? And he explained, like, you're in this band, you're recording your second album, why can't you buy it? And I had no good argument, no defense at all to put up. So, okay, fuck it, I'm going to buy it. So I bought it. And here he is, or she is, whoever, whatever. Don't know if you can actually see it. It's like a seaweed color. Yeah, and there you go. There, that looks better. The color was not my was not something I would have thought I wanted or anything. It's just, it was just this model. It just looked unique. I've never seen anything really like this before, and not a lot after either. It's a proper Jackson Randy Rose model. Unfortunately, and the big difference also, this one has a Floyd Rose tremolo. So that's another thing. But when I brought this out to start playing it, and I haven't brought this out since 99, when that's the last time I used it, and that's when I put it back in the case, because in 1999 we got endorsed by ESP, but again I chose the Randy Rhodes model. Anyway, never mind that, because we've gone through that already. But so when I brought this out to play on it, it's like all the strings were very, very loose. And I don't know why that happens. Maybe it's time. I don't have no idea why it happened. But because it has a Floyd Rose tremolo, I spent the day restringing it. But then as soon as I start to tune it, the tremolo goes like this, where it's supposed to lie straight. Every time you tighten the strings, it just goes like that. And that's partly because there's only one spring at the back. And now that I think of it, actually now I remember at a later recording, or maybe a later date, I had another guitar that needed more springs in the back, because back here there are springs to tighten the tremolo, the saddle, the tremolo to tighten it, so make sure that it stays in place, and also make sure that you can actually move it up and down and make these these things. Anyway, long rant now. But so I tried to tune it today, but because it's missing two springs in the back here inside, and I believe we took those and put them on another guitar. I just remember this now. I forgot about it completely. But this must have been in 2001 or 2002. We used those springs from this one, and that's why I couldn't tune it properly. Because every time I tightened the nuts over here, the tremolo went like this, and that meant also that the string height was, after a while, was like this high, and it's supposed to be this. So I can't play it, is what I'm getting at now today. Unfortunately, this one is out of commission. I'm gonna have somebody work on it, probably Orvar again, our guitar tech, I'm hoping anyway. So long story about that, it means that for the first time in this whole series, and I had some major problems with some of the guitars because they're old and worn out and sweaty and rusty and shit, this one is the only one that didn't work, the only one that I couldn't get to work, which sucks. But anyway, I'm gonna use this one, like my trusty Sandberg. I mean, this is like my studio guitar, so it's always in here. Anyway, all right. So let's see if we can get some sound going here. Oops, wrong album. Anyway, so let's finish this stuff here. We got some songs to do today, and many of these songs I played live on countless occasions. I don't know how many times, many times. So some of them are going to be easy. I tried to bring out my favorite songs on this album, basically. We'll see. Like, we're going to start with an easy one. So, and this is the first single of the album. Funnily enough, we never made a video. We made three videos for Glory to the Brave, at least two for Renegade, and nothing for Legacy of Kings in between those. Don't know why, but here we go. I'm Made a mistake. I was singing something else in my head. But yeah, you get it. You get the picture. You heard the song before, so you know it. There are a couple of songs on this one that we haven't played for a long time. One that we have played a couple of times in the last 15 years or so is this one, the title track. It's a funny song. It's a really fun song to play. I really enjoy this one. Don't have much to say about it. I don't even remember how that came about, how we wrote it or anything. I don't remember, but it is a favorite of to play live for sure. That's Legacy of Kings for you. Right, so pretty cool, cool song that one. Yeah, I'm just gonna go down here. Let's try At the End of the Rainbow for a second. So, like we were talking about what is it? Guild Wars Times Heating the Cold video. I don't really know what that is, unfortunately. 15 years old, still glorious, okay? I believe you. I just don't know what that is. I know what Guild Wars is, at least that is a video game, but I think so. Anyway, don't throw me off here. I'm trying to play At the End of the Rainbow, right? So, boom. We'll be right back. So that last part, I actually didn't rehearse. That just came from memory from the last time we played that song live. But yeah, I enjoyed playing that one live too. It's a really, it was a live favorite of a lot of people back then. Anyway, we had some fun with that for sure. Let's go on this one. This is a more difficult one because, let's go for Dreamland here. Part of this song, to make this work here, now I have to play the part, like this is made for two guitars, right? So I'm doing so like I'm just doing the chords and the stabs and stuff, but I'm gonna play the Stefan part again, like I did with Trailblazers, I believe it was. So bear with me if I don't know it 100%. I'm gonna try and see if I can remember it. That's Dreamland for you. So today I'm having fun playing, a lot more fun than I thought. So I'm playing a bit longer. I hope you enjoy that. With the power of the ceiling. Hi, Otakaro. I didn't see you there. Yeah, that's a cool one. And of course, we have the all-time classic, this one. So this one is, if you have seen Hammerfall Live ever, you've heard it. Unless your absolute only show with Hammerfall was before, for on the Glory to the Brave tour, on the Tour of the Brave. That was your only show you ever seen, you haven't heard this one live. If you have seen Hammerfall at all afterwards, you have seen this one. Fucking fall. right, this I like the sound coming from this amp and this speaker. I really, really like the angle stuff. Oops, out of beer. Never mind, I'm done now anyway. I just got one more song to play, and this is a little bit special for me. This is called Stronger Than All, and that this one's kind of encompasses everything I wanted out of heavy metal and Hammerfall. So here we go. Right, that's Stronger Than All for you. So about that song, it's interesting. When we played in South America for the first time, which was in 1999, and we played in Chile, I remember this as it was yesterday, because it made such a big impression on all of us that people were actually singing along with the guitar riffs. I've never experienced that, like not in the same, because that was like almost the entire crowd we're singing along with, oh, you know, the whatever, that sucked. But the intro riff, not the intro, like the main riff, not the chorus, but the main riff on this one, when we were playing it. And this was in 99, like I said, so way before, no, sorry, not way before, anyway, never mind. It was anyway a big surprise to us. We were like blown away by that, and that I will never ever forget that. Now, I mean, this is not uncommon anymore. People have done it many times since then for us, but for us, for Hammerfall, that was the very first time that we ever experienced that, and it was an unbelievably cool experience, among many other things that we had in South America in that time. South American fans are very special to play for. We hope to be back there very soon again. Anyway, let's not get that go down that. Now I'm gonna finish this off by saying, please visit our web shop if you can. We have oh, the fuck! Now I lost the there we go. We have this web shop that we normally. So here we go. Never mind. I'm getting tired now. Hammerfall official merchandise. You can buy this here. You can buy merchandise of Hammerfall in a lot of places. This is the official one. I'm sure that if you check it out, you can find something that you enjoy there. We got that one, for example, in case you haven't bought that. That's a vinyl of Dominion and a second to one single that we only were supposed to sell on the shows this year. But we didn't do that many shows anymore, so we got a couple left over. We got this one too. It's a second to one t-shirt. It's a pretty nice album cover by Samwise Didier, our fantastic album artist, cover artist. Yeah, the backside says one hammer to rule them all, which I think is pretty cool. Anyway, and as usual, you will find the web shop here, hammerfall.net/merchandise. Check it out if you want to. And like I said, every time here, every band today appreciates this, because we are not going to do any shows until next year. So anything that you can do to support any of your favorite bands, it's very most welcome. Very appreciated. Anyway, this will be, like I said, the final album version, Hammerfall TV. So we've done 11 episodes now. Right now, I'm not sure exactly what's going to happen. We're going to take a short break. I mean, I'm happy to get my Friday nights back. Let me tell you that. It's been fun as hell to do this with you. But I'm kind of missing our Friday game nights that we had at home, for example. Even though I am actually at home, it's just a different building. It's this takes up a lot of my time and a lot of my efforts. So it's going to be good to have some vacation. That's basically what I'm saying. Some holiday from Hammerfall TV for a couple of weeks. Don't know how long, but a couple of weeks at least. But we will be back. I have definitely several ideas that we can make this better and improve on this thing. I'm sure that we will do that in the future. We will be back. We'll all let you know on social media. And as usual, you have the social media links here, in case you don't know. YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, we're on all of them. And don't forget our webpage. It's also got all the stuff you need. So we're going to announce that there. We will be back, but right now I'm taking a summer vacation or summer break. Anyway, I'm hoping you guys have had a good time watching this, and I'm hoping that you will have a great summer despite the chaos and what's going on with the coronavirus in the world today. But, you know, just stay safe, stay heavy, stay metal. This has been Oscar for Hammerfall TV. Thank you, Joachim, for joining, of course, today. It was only fitting that we got to discuss the Legacy of Kings album together. We will be back, and not just me. All of us will be back somehow, somewhen, sometime. All right, thanks for watching. I'm just bullshitting now. Thanks for watching, guys. Take care. See you so much. See you soon. thank you so much for watching. take care. All right.